Bill Adamson, former PhD graduate, and also to Richard Campbell from David Big for thankful joining us in this Friday seminar. So, Doctor, welcome. I open the floor for you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Juan. Can you listen to me? It's okay? Okay. Well, first of all, good morning. I talked today about tail infiltration, very interesting topic. Tail infiltration practices in Mexican gold and silver mines. First of all, I would like to acknowledge my co-authors, Peter Monroe, Mineralis, and Salvador Gomez from Fresnillo. And also I would like to acknowledge all my colleagues in Mexico that were pleased to provide this information. Took a while, but eventually they provide information. They're very busy. And also to Mineralis Consultants and to Fresnillo. I wanted to show this first because this topic is very, very important for our industry. We have tailing dams in all our operations. And we have a lot of accidents as well in all over the different countries. And they say here 40 accidents in the last 10 years, so about 4 accidents per year. And because of that, filtered dry stack in a storage facility, as it offers many advantages over thick and tailing storage facilities, provides a good option for our industry to reduce the number of accidents. Today we'll talk about several topics. First of all, I described the Mexican mines using tail infiltration, which was the first task that we had to do when we started this work. We did find out the key reasons for selecting tail infiltration. Many of the answers came from the data they sent us. Some did not reply, and we used their technical stories to be able to know the answers. Also, we'll talk about quantifiable benefits on reagent savings and gold and silver recoveries. We want to include this part because it's telling the position in conventional and filtered tailings storage facility. It is really important to know the difference, how well it works and how the water works, because that helps us to appreciate why it is important tailings filtration. Also, we'll summarize with some learning from tailing filtration data, conclusions, and some suggested takeaways. Also, we want to emphasize that this particular work is, the focus is more metallurgical than structural, as many other papers. So this is what is mainly different in this work. Now, first of all, we see here the map of Mexico. About 120 operations, these red dots in here, all over the place. And then in blue, we have the listed different companies that we, companies, mines that we talked about. Minera Cuscatlán in the state of Oaxaca, which has a lot of social issues. And together with, this is Torres in Guerrero, Media Luna, also they have a lot of issues. So these are, I mean, to type this type of process that we are describing, help them about to avoid this type of problem, social problems. Then we have San Martin in Jalisco, Del Toro and La Parrilla in Zacatecas, Tayoltita in Durango, La Encantada in Coahuila, and Pinos Altos in Chihuahua. We also have another one that is called Anonymous, because they sent us information, but they wanted to basically just to keep them anonymous. Because of that, we just put their information. In general, the characteristics of the operations that we'll discuss is this 9 mines, daily throughputs from 1,000 to 13,000 tons per day, which is what is typical in Mexican mines, in many Mexican mines. Gold values from basically nothing to 4.8 grams per ton. Silver values from 68 to 330. Mexico, as we know, is a big silver producer, so a lot of silver deposits. The process used is merry-go-round. It's the most common one because it's the one that is normally used when you have a lot of metal, as it is silver. Except in Minera Media Luna that has low silver and use CIP, and Minera Cuscatlán that they use only, they recover all their values by flotation. Also very interesting to observe here is that five of the operations are owned by First Mine District. Okay, let's start with the first mine. This is Media Luna. Media Luna, it is in an area where there are mountains, and also there is a big river in here, Mexican River, aquifer. And it was conditioned for the ground of the license to operate, to have tailing filtration. But also what they describe in the comments in the technical story, that if they wanted to build a conventional tailing dam in this type of terrain, normally they would require a lot of area, and well, of course use a lot of wood. So that was a plus. And also they would reduce potential social issues, which they know about that. And also this is a seismic area, very, very heavy earthquakes. So having this type of facility will help to deal with all those issues. This is Minera Media Luna infrastructure for the filtration, 13,000 tons per day. And as we can see, filtration means a good infrastructure, a large infrastructure to do the work and a high capital. Many advantages, of course. Inside this building, we have, first of all, it is highlighted the low filtration rates. And because of that, they have to use many filters, basically seven filters in here. They are the 7 dm filters, 170 plates each one, 2.5 or 2.5, so it's a lot of area. The grind size, 75 to 100 microns, filtration rates, 0.1 tons per hour per square meter. The slurry is sent to the tops before filtration. This is very important because, we just complete the desalination of the contercurrent decantation, but we have a lot of cyanide, a lot of values is still there. And the more water we recover, or the more water we send directly to the toxins, means that you will recover less cyanide and less values. So that's why this point is important. So the slurry is sent to the toxins before filtration. So they cannot recover so much values because of that, or not so much cyanide. In other operations, what they do is they for example, they send 60% as much as they can pump, they send to the detox. And then they add process water so that they can recover as many values as possible. But not, was not the case in the operations that we are discussing. Also, mechanical availability of these filters is around 92%, and initially during commission it was about 72%. Issues that they had, lack of commissioning experience, lack of experience in commissioning, and high clay. High clay will be an issue that always be available with tailing filtrations and will be repeated by all of them. Stick to filter clot, filtration rate is reduced, moisture increases. Now let's go to Pinos Altos, Agnico Eagle. In this case, the key reasons that they mentioned of selecting tailing filtration was they saw a long dry season demanding the managed water efficiency. So it means that from December to May, the expected precipitation based on the stats was 50 millimeters per month. And they thought, well, I guess we better go to tailing filtration. And that was the main reason that why they selected tailing filtration, because recover most of the water, and because of the stability during the rainy season. The, people that have worked in this type of operation. It's, you have the tailing down, then comes a bigger storm. And you really need to be there during the storm, because a lot of water is going to go down. And even when you have the infrastructure, still, you're not sleeping well. And they're very good TSS, but still, that is the feeling, yeah, when you have this type in a heavy storm. Again, regarding the infrastructure for 6,000 tons per day operation, they have the filtration building, the filter feed tank, and the detox reactors 1 and 2. So this is the place. Now, inside the building, we have, first of all, a couple of remarks, low filtration rates and high costs. They have 5 autotech large horizontal filters, 50 plates, 2 by 2.5, grind size 125 microns. Again, this slurry is sent to the tops before filtration, same as Media Luna. Up to 30% is used as a backfill, so it means that they filter, and about 30% of the mass is sent to as a backfill. Then they install a paste thickener, and now they have the option of using the filtrate or using the thickener to produce the backfill. The filter rate is very similar to the other one, 0.13 tons per hour per square meter. The total cost is 315 to 340, which is basically equal to the cost of grinding, which makes this operation well one of the expensive areas to run. Currently, the filter tailings are placed in an open pit. Initially, they were using an open stream tailing to see that they are, but now they're sending that to an open pit. Mechanical availability, 90%, moisture content, about 17.5. TSF operation is simple. They have like that, basically. After they filtrate that, they send all the conveyor belts to the discharge point, and then a machine basically will compact the tailing and will distribute it. Yeah. We'll see that later on, not in detail, but enough to understand what they mean. Issues, high clay, high moisture content, reduced filtration capacity, blockages in conveyor belt transfer points. Now, let's go to a different state. This is in Oaxaca. This is Minera Cuscatlán. And the first that we can observe is surrounded by communities and lack of space. So this is the community of San José del Progreso, 6,200 people, but there are a lot of communities around. Lack of space, even when we say a lot of space, but also they only own this part in here. Okay, so they had not too much options to deposit the tailings, and because of that they went for tailing filtration. The filter building is somewhere in here, it's about 1.8 kilometers, and it's trucked all the way up to here. They highlight the advantages, higher process water recovery, lower fresh water requirement, which is very important when you are close to a community, lesser impact on the environment, which is again very important. You don't want the air to blow and to spread all this all the sand in town. So it's again help you a lot with the social problem. This is the building, Minera Cuscatlán. Again, high operating costs, they remarked that. They didn't give us the cost, but they remarked that. And lack of spare parts and specialized technician provided by suppliers when they were commissioning the filters. They have 4 FL Smith 2x2 meters and 1 DM 2.5. This is a 3,000 tons per day operation. Again, this is a flotation operation. pH of 95 microns. Filtration recovers most of the water, unless air is needed for TSF. 30% of the feed is diverted to the paste field. Moisture content about 14%. In this case, they have no issues with clay because this is an underground mine. basically clays is more associated with open pit mines. This is the anonymous site. First remark they did is they had high water requirements and not enough space to build a new conventional pier set. This is a 13,000 tons per day operation. They have, again, high water requirements for the CCD. How the CCD works is that you leach the material and then you send that to thickeners, and basically with water you remove from the slurry the bios, which are sent to the Meritpro process, which you add zinc powder to be able to precipitate the vanos. But they had a lot of issues with water. Normally you have like 5-6 thickeners, and then they have two lines, so it was an enormous amount of water that they were needed. They were having all the silver losses, reagent losses, and they wanted to increase the process of water recovery. So the next step was to go to tailings filtration for them. They have 10 filters, micrometers, 90 flakes, 2.1 by 2, pH of 140. Oh, sorry, and again, just to remark it here, low filtration rates and high operating costs, which was also a new remark. In this particular operation, unlike the other two, the slurry is not detoxed for filtration, so they do not detox. So they remove all the water. The consistency of the tailing is such that you don't release water after you filter. It's okay. Okay. So they use that advantage. Total availability 83%, very low. Moisture content 18%. Filter rate 0.14 tons per hour per square meter. Filtration cost that they report, 325, which basically was equal to the one reported by Pinos Altos. Now, highlights the importance of tailing characterization and clay control. The clay control is done through open pit and underground mine or composite, so they really need to do that to be able to operate, and since they have the underground and the open pit, they can do that. Issues clay, whenever it is higher than design, they had a lot of operation and mechanical issues, the same as the others. Sudden breakers of clock plates, work parts from pumps and discharge pipes, high wearing feed and discharge valves, leaks of filtrate solution while filter is opening, failure in sensors due to excess moisture. Yeah. So that's, yeah, they had a hard time. They also emphasize and provide, they say, high savings in reagents and significant increase in gold and silver recoveries. They are the only operation that have the before and after, because they went from a conventional to a tailing filtration, having a cyanidation stage. Higher availability of process solution to the CCDs. And they report savings in cyanide, for example, of 19 cents per ton, and significant increase in gold and silver recoveries, 3-4 and 2-4 in terms of dollars. So they were losing a lot of values, basically. And that helps to provide the throughput of 13,000 tons per day and recovering the values to the standard that they wanted. Now we go to the operations of First Majestic. And as we would see, the main comment is they are surrounded by communities, or not common, characteristics here, characteristics, and experience lack of water. So we have San Dimas, which is called Tayotita, La Parrilla, Del Toro, San Martini, and La Encantada Mine. Let's start with San Dimas, Tayotita. Basically, what they say is that, well, the operation just grew with the time, and just all the storage capacity was depleted. They have a town, they have mountains, These are the fairy dancing here. So basically, they complete or they finish this space, and they're using now this for the tiny filtration as well. So very efficient to save space. 3,000 tons per day, potential water and community issues. Basically, always that we have a community around the mines, we have the responsibility to be very careful. And because of that, is this type of options give us that advantage. Then we have La Parrilla. Again, potential water and community issues. In front of the mine, they have the town, San Jose de La Parrilla. This is the population, farming area, precipitation of 400 millimeters per year, so not too much water, 2,000 tons per day. Then another one, we have in the town of Chalchihuites in Zacatecas, a population of 10,000 people, farming area. And on top of this mine, there is another mine in the town. So the water again becomes really, really, really scarce and a big responsibility for the company to have a response to that. And if they want to be in business, in the case of the vision of this company, well, we better go to tell you the treasures in the beginning, because that's the only option. Now we go to San Martin, silver mine, in the state of Jalisco, potential water and community issues. They have the San Martin de Bolaños town here. This is the population, again, farming area, 850 tons per day. And they replace the conventional TSF by filtration tanks. They commissioned this actually in November of last year, so this is a fairly new. Also in like 2011 or so, or 2012, they ran off, the river ran dry, and they had to also build some infrastructure to bring the water from 30 kilometers away. So they, basically, they, to keep the business and to keep well the community, tail infiltration is basically a solution, or maybe the only solution. This is La Encantada. La Encantada is in the Coahuila Desert, 10 to 20 millimeters per year, so this is not too much water. And this is 4,000 tons per day. So what happened is that below there are many mountains and there is water on the ground, but from many wells that they own. But still, I mean, there is the desert and this is a clear solution to be able to keep in business. Now, we wanted to include this part because it's important to talk about the two most common processes that are used when they build a tailing dam. One is upstream, which is the most common one when you don't have excessive water or this is not a seismic area, then you can use this one. And most of the operations will be upstream. But also this style is also used for tailing filtration. It's also used because it's very, very, very easy to build since you are now piling the filter tank. So it's fairly easy to find space and it is properly compacted, you don't have issues. And downstream is essentially seismic and heavy rain areas. So this is, the top one is the upstream. It is like, this line here shows the phreatic the phreatic level, but let's forget about that. I just use this, stroke this to tell you how it is built when they use tailing filtration. Basically, you start still with a starter dam. And the starter dam, basically, everything will go to here. In a conventional tailing with water, in the case that some water comes up to this, normally they have a filter in here that allows the water to go through and they collect all that that water. But with filtration, that's not an issue. Then you put, I mean, you start with the first layer, and you compact everything, and it's just a very, very solid and safe structure. And then you start almost rising this. And then again, you put it here, let's say 5 meters all the way up to here, and then you compact, and then you grow that way. And then you put some viral material in here. So because of that, we can see that it's not a very expensive way to build. And because of that has been adopted for tail filtration, this type of method. Well, it's the opposite with downstream. The downstream method is essentially seismic and heavy rain areas. And you start with this down station here. But it is very different to this one because you see how you grow it here in every stage, all the barrel material you have to build. So here was basically, you only cover this surface with barrel material, and basically just to reforest the area and all that. But here you need support, you need a lot of support to be able to be above the safe standard for the tailings, 1.2, 1.3. And this costs a lot of money. Now, this is an upstream. This is Media Luna TSF. And you have the tailing facilities in here. And then all the filter cake is transported to these conveyor belts. And basically, it's placed in different areas here. And you just compact that and start growing. And that's easy to do with this. That's not a problem. However, when you have a downstream one, well, you are in the mountains. First of all, you have to make the space because there is no space. Of course, there are some spaces, but not. Still, you need to dig millions of tons here to be able to build this and to do other. If you do not have the right quality of rock, I mean, that's even more expensive because you have to bring it from wherever it is. And I think this is the second stage of this one. But for example, the second station here, this one costs $16 million. So it's only one stage, and the other one will be more and more expensive. So it's a lot of money. It still is cheaper than the filtration tailings. But the filtration tailings, you have a lot of advantages, a lot of additional advantages. Okay? And of course, you have the water here that you have to. This is not a seismic area, it's just a heavy rain area. But so it requires more area. Every level rises borrow material, moving millions of tons, very high costs. Easier to find a business case for tailing filtration, I think. Now, this is not the same as the other one. This is another downstream in another place in the mountains. And this has already get to the closer stage, but you can see all the opening that was in here now is completely. See, it's completely covered because that's the only way that you can keep it safe and okay. And then now you are reforesting that and just to be the same as what was before. And that costs a lot of money again. So that's, I think, tailing filtration, even when it's very expensive, has also, you have to see the whole picture to be able to take a better decision. This is Pinos Altos. Pinos Altos, initially they start with an upstream tailing facility. Not too much space, but because it's filter tailing, then you can put it basically everywhere. You compact, you have all the upstream design, all the routes, but there is no risk because there is no water. And now, well, I guess it's even safer because they're putting that in an open pit. This is the upstream Agnico Eagle TSF when it was still in operation. You can see the label I was saying. In here will be all the to collect the water in case that there is some water, but again there is no water in here. And then it's really cheap because you just build to the top. You have the equipment and you bring the material all the way up to here. So it's quite convenient. Now you have the open pit in here, you bring all the materials all the way up to here, and you use this shaft in there. Okay, so it's quite convenient. Actually, this is underground, below here there is an underground one. That's why also they needed to, in the middle, they put a 5 meter of compacted concrete to be able to seal that basically. Even when there is no water, because of the rainwater and all that, you have to put filters inside, which are fairly easy to do because you have a permeable area where you collect the water and you just pump that water. So it's fairly conventional. Now, some learnings about what we have said. Paying infiltrate rates are lower than the rule of thumb of 0.5. This rule of thumb is in the flotation concentrate or sulfide concentrate that normally are around a pH of 38 microns. And this is just as a rule of thumb, 0.5. You compare this 0.5 with the others. Well, basically, you need much more area when you have tail infiltration. And that's why the cost increased. The major cost is of this higher area is clay. And clay is not normally a significant constituent of the of a sulfide concentrate. Now also we have a common benchmark performance, running time about 90%. Filter moisture from 14 to 18%. Operating cost 325. Operating cost of tail infiltration is equivalent to random. Respondents reported dissatisfaction in their dealings with the suppliers of filtration equipment. Basically, they felt that suppliers could have done more to support the equipment on what it was a new slurry filtration application. So, some conclusions. Tail infiltration is a common process used in many Mexican gold and silver mines. The key reasons for selecting tail infiltrations are reduced freshwater consumption, insufficient space to build a conventional TSF, reduce social issues, improve case for granting of operating license. While I'm saying this in here, I have seen many cases where you have a conventional TSF and you are in operation and it still takes you 3 years to get the permit, so you need to do a lot of things to be able to hold that, and that costs a lot of money and time in production. So again, there are a lot of reasons why this method could be evaluated with all those reasons. When it comes to corporate, as it is summarized by this president and CEO of Corp, David Garofalo, when it comes to corporate social responsibility, well, it's all about water. So water is the issue. The chemical case for going to tail infiltration for a cyanide leaching merit row operation with high silver field grade is the potential large reduction in solution losses. And an ancillary benefit is removing as much water as possible before the justification is made, as we explained before. There are technology limitations in high throughput operations, as they require many filters, and this results in high maintenance and operating costs, high operating costs. However, this type of this limitation is about to be changed, hopefully. There is the Rose Mountain operation in Tucson, a 90,000 tons per day operation. They are permitted on the condition that they tell you when they filter and dry stuff. So, well, this is one case, but I'm sure there are other cases now that is the case, because, I mean, this is common. But anyway, this is a good example of how, what is the situation now? High capital costs, low filtration efficiency in ores with high lead. It is not normal practice in metallurgical test work to determine the filtration characteristics of ore as opposed to a concentrate. It has the new technology risks with use of the bottlenecking issues and longer time to achieve the design throughput. Okay, we cannot go away from that. And also, you need to be more accurate with the water balance in this type of operation. A lot of learning. So, suggested takeaways. There can be a sound process case for leaching operations, especially for silver. Characterization and management of clays need to be part of a tailing filtration project operation, as we just observed or mentioned. Operating cost of tailing filtration is in principle not subject to economies of scale, as the outcome drivers are filter cap thickness and area. So, regardless of the throughput, basically will be linear because of those two drivers. The high cost of tailing filtration will provide incentives for coarse particle beneficiation, as coarsening the upfront grinding products and coarsening the upfront grinding products. This confirms earlier productions about the future importance of tailing thickening and flotation, that the back end of the concentrator operation is starting to drive the mineral processing companies. Oh, that was my presentation.